عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وأزواجه أمهات المؤمنين وعلى من اتبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. Acting upon the Sunnah, Ikhwa, a lot of us assume that the connection with the Quran is listening or reciting only. As a matter of fact, Abdullah ibn Abbas stated that Jibreel alayhi salam every year would come فيدارس النبي القرآن. He would study the Quran with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. For like, you know, you're going to give a share to the recitation, a share to listening to the Quran, you should also give a share to trying to understand the Quran during this blessed month, because Rabbul Alameen اختص هذا الشهر بالقرآن. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the Quran one of the particulars of شهر رمضان. شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن. Now it's up to you. You can initiate the you know, the study of the Quran in your own. And if you wish, attend these lectures, which is going to be 20-25 minutes, inshallah. I'm going to try to limit it to that. But it's a very, it's not like, it was not meant for you to just feel good. It's meant for you to understand how to understand the Quran. So it may sound a little bit academic, but that's the intention behind it, teaching it. This is the first lecture, and I chose to introduce the subject through three introductions. First of all, the main subject of these lectures is As-Sab'u At-Tawal, the seven long chapters of the Quran. So the first introduction addresses is categorizing the Quran into segments, like I just said, As-Sab'u At-Tawal. Is it something that that is innovative, is a bid'ah, or something that is that has some basis in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? So we will talk about this one in a 5 to 7 minutes introduction. The second introduction is the order of the mushaf we have. Obviously, and I assume all of you would realize that it is not the same chronological, this is good English, the order of the revelation. It is not. The mushaf we have, the order of the chapters, is not the same order of the mushaf when it was revealed. And we'll explain what is the wisdom, why. And finally, inshallah, I will share a story with you which somehow would illustrate our approach in studying the seven long chapters. Because obviously, we're not talking about analytical tafsir, which is a tafsir al-tahlili, that we're going to go over every single verse, and we can't do that in the month of Ramadan. That would take somehow somewhat longer than that. Nor we're doing thematical, which is al-mawdu'i, tafsir al-mawdu'i. We're doing an approach called maqasidic. You look at the chapter and you find out the major message, or the universal message, or the encompassing message of the entire chapter, and you explain the chapter in light of that. And we'll explain this, inshallah, where this approach comes from. And inshallah, you will understand it. So are we ready?
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
You know, it's really important, ya ikhwa. This is the key to connect with the Quran. طيب, let me begin here. The divine segmentation of the Quran. Is it a bid'ah to do that? No, it is not. What is the, always we have to have an evidence. The hadith fi musnad al-Imam Ahmad, the narrator of the hadith, a companion whose name you may not hear often, his name is Wathila ibn al-Asqa' radiyallahu anhu, who heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And again, before I go into the matn, the contents of the hadith, when I say Musnad Ahmad, when I say this hadith in Musnad Ahmad, should I just accept it? No. Always. If I say Bukhari or Muslim, I don't have to go further, because there is a silent ijma' sukuti, consensus, that any hadith that comes from al-Bukhari, any hadith that comes from Muslim, is authentic. We call it ijma' sukuti. What does it mean? It means that this statement has been uttered in front of a lot of scholars throughout history, and no one objected to it. Yeah, sukuti, yani ijma' sukuti, silent consensus. But when I say Musnad Ahmad, Sunan al-Tirmidhi, Sunan al-Nasa'i, Ibn Majah, Ibn Hibban, and Musannaf Abdul Razzaq, I still need an expert of hadith to tell me that this hadith is what? Sahih. Because not every hadith inside these volumes is authentic. You got that? So now I said Musnad Ahmad, who authenticated this hadith? Al-Sheikh Al-Albani, rahimahullah, authenticated the hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, أعطيت مكان التوراة السبع الطوال وأعطيت مكان الزبور المئين وأعطيت مكان الإنجيل المثاني وفضلت بالمفصل. هذا هو الحديث. I was given in place of the Torah the seven long chapters, our subject, and I was given in place of the Injil Al-Ma'in, and we're going to come to identity of these. And I was given in place of Injil Al-Mathani, and I was complimented, privileged with extra, which is what? Al-Mufassal. So that's the evidence. So there is a ground to segment, to break down the Quran into segments. طيب. Let's identify these four categories. السبع الطوال, there is a debate. Technically, there are eight to begin with. But there is a debate between the scholars whether Al-Anfal and Al-Tawbah or Yunus or Al-Tawbah are joined to be one. But the authentic, يعني, the opinion that we adopt in this study, that Al-Anfal and Al-Tawbah. So here is السبع الطوال, the seven long chapters who come at the beginning of the Mus'haf. Count with me. What is number one? Huh? Al-Baqarah. Al-Fatiha is obviously at the beginning of the Mus'haf, but is not a long chapter, although the entire Quran explains it technically. So what is number one? Next. Al-Baqarah, Al Imran, next. Al-Nisa, next. Al-Ma'idah. And those are four madani. Four madani. There is a password that the Quran starts with a four madani. Although we know that the first chapters were revealed are what? Makki. I'm going to explain why. What is next? Two Makki. Come one after another. An'am and A'raf. A'raf. An'am and A'raf. Then the last one, which is technically two, but joined together, which is Al-Anfal and Al-Tawbah or Bara'ah. And there is no traditional separator between those two surahs. What is the traditional separator in the Quran? Al-Basmala. We call it Al-Basmala. Al-Basmala. You can abbreviate it Al-Basmala, which is what? There is no separation between the two. طيب, what about Al-Ma'in? The chapters of the Quran which exceed the 100 verses and more. You guys don't speak English, what? Were you asleep? Huh?
you have suhoor, right? What about al-mathani? Al-mathani, they say less than that, 100 and less. What about al-mufassal? Of course, there is, yani they said Yunus until Taha, although some of the other chapters still exceed relatively the 100, they said this is al-ma'in. Al-mathani, they said Taha all the way until al-hujurat. Now, al-mufassal, which is the special, the special give to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because the Prophet said, "I was given what extra, which is al-mufassal, from qaf all the way to what in nas." Why it's called al-mufassal? Because it doesn't because of the repetition of al-basmala all the time. You short surahs and Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Bismillah. That's why it's called a lot of tafsil in them. Al-tawasul. Al-fawasil. Min al-mufassal. Jazakallahu khair, Sheikh Rajab. He said al-mufassal min al-fawasil. You know when you when you write in Arabic, the comma in English. You do what? Comma. So there is a lot of what we call this. We call this fasla. Fasla. In Arabic, fasla, which is the commas. Some scholars broke it down, Sheikh Rajab, and there is a difference of opinion. Qaf until amma yatasa'aloon is the long mufassal. There is a middle mufassal from al-naba until al-duha. And the last is the short mufassal. Yani this is extra, inshallah. So we're done with introduction. We got it? Can I quiz you? What is the evidence that we can break down the Quran into segments? Hilmi, you're going to say it. Huh? Okay. Alayhi salatu wassalam. Okay, Jazakallahu khairan. Good enough. At least you mentioned this is a hadith. طيب. Obviously, like I mentioned earlier, we know that the order of the mushaf we have, we call this mushaf what? This mushaf has a special name. What do we call it? Al-mushaf al-what? Al-Uthmani. Al-mushaf al-Uthmani. The Uthmani mushaf. This order is not the order of the revelation. The chronicle, the chronic sequence of the chapters. For example, what was the first ever revelation of the Quran? What chapter? Which is the first five verses of it? What? Al-Alaq, Iqra. You know what number in the Quran is Al-Alaq? 96. Chapter 96. So if the Quran has been put together in the order of, if it was arranged in that manner, chapter 96 would have been what chapter what? Chapter 1. Good enough. Now, that brings another question. What is the wisdom? But before answering this question, here is a very interesting question. Is the order, the final arrangements of the Mus'haf, which is al-Mus'haf al-Uthmani we have, is it tawqifi or ijtihadi? And I'm intentionally using these terms. As a Muslim, you should become familiar with these terms. First of all, let's break down these terms. What do we mean by tawqifi? Divinely decreed. Allah, through Jibreel, subhanahu wa ta'ala, through Jibreel, alayhi salam, instructed the Prophet to put the Mus'haf in that order. Al-Baqarah, Al-Imran, Al-Nisa. Or it was left to ijtihad. What is ijtihad? Scholarly examination. That scholars decided. What is the answer? Yes to what? Is it tawqifi or ijtihadi? Tawqifi. Although, I want to, for the Al-Aman Al-Almiyyah, the scholars actually differed on this. Regarding that chapters, not the order of the verses, just to be careful, I'm talking about what? The chapters, not the other order. Like the order within the chapter is tawqifi, done. But the order of the mushaf, the actual chapters, that in Nisa comes after Al-Imran, before Al-Ma'idah. The correct answer, brothers and sisters in Islam, is it tawqifi? It is tawqifi. There is a logical justification for that. And there is more than one evidence to validate that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was instructed to place the Quran in that order, in that fashion. Let's begin with the logical. If Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam would have left the Quran without that order which we have, wouldn't you expect the Sahaba to disagree on the order of the surahs?
Yes,
they would. If the Prophet did not leave it, they would. Some of the Sahaba would see Al Imran should come before Al-Baqarah. That's an opinion, ijtihadi. That is why the Mus'haf has to be passed on in that format. It has to. The textual evidence, take for example, they asked Uthman ibn Affan, radiallahu anhu, why didn't you include Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim or al-Basmala before Bara'ah, before al-Tawbah? What did he say, Sheikh Rajab? Hakada, this is how we received it. This is how the Prophet told us what? To do it. Hamad, how are you? Yes, Ramadan Mubarak to you. So this is how the Quran was passed on to us. Here is really, that would require, I know some of you may not have slept last night, but I really want your attention now. Because this is a password right here, a password to the entire subject. All of this I was entertaining you. What is the wisdom that the order changed? ما الحكمة في اختلاف النزول عن الترتيب؟ The Quran was revealed in 23 years and 2 months, to be particular, to be يعني precise. Now, the Quran dealt with a community that had their own challenges, their own circumstances. And many cases, the revelation would be responsive to these situations. That is why one of the sciences of the Quran, we call it what? من علوم القرآن اللي هي أسباب what? أسباب النزول. Why did this verse was revealed? What triggered Jibreel to come down? So also this community evolved from complete disbelief in Mecca to what? To establishing what? An Islamic embodiment system, Islamic state. I know that the guys who record don't like that word, but I'm going to say it. Islamic entity that required legislations to organize the lives of the citizens of the state and their interaction with institutions, constitutions, laws. The order of the revelation dealt with a community that evolved from one individual, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to an entire ummah, entire empire, that actually started going head to head with the Byzantine, with the Persian. So that evolution, but after this community is completed, is done, now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His divine wisdom rearranged it to serve you and me until the day of judgment. You're getting that? The Quran is not going to start with the Makki because we're what? Do we need the Makki? I mean, in the sense of, we need the Makki, of course, to be steadfast. But the Makki Quran was meant to bring people to Islam. Talking about Tawheed. It's still important to emphasize Tawheed. But the order has to what? Pair the Makki and the Madani together. The new order has to what? Be what? Well, like if you go through the order of the Mus'haf, you will find Makki, Madani, Makki, Madani, Makki, Madani, Makki, Madani, until that. Because the Quran is addressing us, not what? Not the Sahaba. Did you get this one? Yes. Abu Yasser, did you get it? أنا شافك نايم كده مش عارف ليه. Huh? Did you get it? أيوه.
هناك علم آخر بسايد أسباب النزول، علم مستقل له، علم المناسبة.
سيوطي، نعم.
نعم، علم المناسبة بين الآيات والسورة.
نعم. Sheikh Hafidhullah Allah mentioned something that is also important, that there is a science of the Quran, which Imam al-Suyuti skilled, man, the English is not coming, excelled, which is the science of connectivity. Why the surah ended with that verse and started with that verse? Why al-Baqarah and Ala Imran came after one another? He actually extracted wisdoms, pearls of wisdom behind that connectivity. If you understood number two, introduction number two, we can move to number three, which is a very interesting story. And we close with that, which will explain the methodology which we will use to explain the seven chapters of the Quran. Let me ask you this question. What was the first ever problem the Muslim community faced, encountered, after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and after the completion of the revelation? Name it. Huh?
Not paying
zakah. Okay, any other suggestion?
Going back to
apostasy.
Deciding the next khalifa.
Deciding the next khalifa. Any other suggestion? You want to know something? The first problem was actually accepting that Rasulullah died. Can you imagine Umar with his wisdom? But we're not rebuking him here, okay? Hopefully you don't understand that. He took a sword and he said, whoever says the Prophet died, I will do what? They wouldn't, as if they did not expect the Prophet to die, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you know, one of the very touching statements that really gets to you in Fatima radiallahu anha, the daughter of the Prophet, said to Anas, Hana عليكم أن تحثوا التراب على وجه رسول الله يا أنس. Did you have that courage to actually throw sand on the face of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in the grave? It's very moving. The Sahaba basically started having this attitude. They sat down and they are not moving, they are not doing anything. Yani one of the most profound description of the scene, كَأَنَّ عَلَى رُؤُوسِهِمُ الطَّيْرُ. birds could land on their heads. You know, when a bird lands on your head, that means you're what? You're who was absent from that scene? Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. He was in a place, according to Hadith Aisha of Sahih Bukhari, called the Sunh, a suburb of Medina. He returned and he looked at the Muslim community sitting down, being so passive. He immediately entered into the chamber of his daughter, because we know Rasulullah died where? In the chamber of who? Aisha radiallahu anha. So he saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam laying down. He kissed his forehead and he made that beautiful statement, طِبْتَ حَيًّا وَمَيِّتَ أَمَّا الْمَوْتَ الَّتِي كَانَتْ عَلَيْكَ فَقَدْ ذُقْتَهَا. As for the death which is ordained upon every human, you already have tasted it. And then he walks out to the community and he addresses them using the Quran. He is employing the Quran to solve the problem. He given his understanding of a verse, which verse 144 of Surah Al-Imran, chapter 344, if you want to follow me. He given first his understanding. So he introduced that understanding, saying, من كان يعبد محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم فإن محمدا قد مات ومن كان يعبد الله فإن الله حي لا يموت. Whoever worships Muhammad, Muhammad is what? Is dead. But if you worship Allah, Allah is ever living. Remember what was the problem of the Sahaba, that the acceptance that Rasulullah died. Now there are multiple, more than one verse in the Quran that can actually resolve that matter. But why Abu Bakr Siddiq chose that particular verse? There is a verse in the Quran that straightforward addresses the Prophet saying what to him? Innaka, innaka mayyit. وَإِنَّهُمْ You're dead. Allah is not telling him that you will die. He say what? Consider yourself what? And they will die. But chose that verse. First of all, when was this verse revealed? 8 years ago. The same exact criteria and the same exact reaction. I don't want to go because I promised to do 20 minutes, possibly hit 20 minutes now, right? Huh? I said 25, not 20, right? A similar situation in the Battle of Uhud, after the archers made the mistake, the Muslims were defeated. Although this is something of debate. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam became under a severe and aggressive attack to the extent that Shaytan could a rumor that the Prophet has died. Rasulullah was killed. The Prophet was killed. A rumor actually spread in the battlefield. Upon hearing that rumor, some companions withdraw. Is that in the past, withdraw? Past? Withdrew from the battleground and they sat down. What is the evidence for that? A companion by the name of Anas ibn al-Nadr, he made a promise because he missed on Badr, that if Allah would enable him again, he would do this and this and this and this. To the extent that a lot of the companions mentioned that this verse in Surah Al-Ahzab, was revealed regarding him. من المؤمنين رجال صدقوا ما عاهدوا الله عليه. نسأل الله أن نكون منهم يا رب. فأز أنس is advancing, was advancing in the battlefield to do his part, he noticed that some Sahaba, some companions withdrew from the battleground and they are sitting down. They asked them, why are you sitting down like that? They said, Rasulullah is dead. He was killed. What did Anas say to them? Huh? A statement, ya ikhwa, that we have to echo. قوموا فموتوا على ما مات عليه. Stand up and die for what he died for, if he's truly killed. And that verse was revealed as a commentary on this. You understand? So this is our approach, brothers and sisters in Islam. We look into a contemporary problem, present day problem. Then we travel across time to the first community and we investigate whether this community experienced that problem or not. If the answer is yes, then we research the Quran to find the verse, the set of verses, the chapter, the set of chapters which was revealed to treat this issue or this problem at their time and bring it back to our time and employ it. Did you get that? That is my approach in the Maqasidic Tafsir. And inshallah, Jazakumullahu Khaira, Brother Ibrahim, there is a blog. All that information, we're going to have a blog where you actually can access this if you want. We can start, maybe Hilmi can initiate that. A WhatsApp group. Naam. But everybody's going to have to give you his number if you like blogs. Where all these materials, all what I said, 4 or 5 pages is there. This is a book, ya ikhwa, alhamdulillah, I put together. And I'm just taking these materials from there. And I'm kind of tweaking it to fit a lecture like this. So inshallah, Brother Ibrahim is going to have the blog ready. We're going to send you a link. Maybe we can start a WhatsApp group. Huh? 7 long chapters group. What about that? طيب جزاكم الله خيرا. Any question? جزاكم الله خيرا. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك والحمد لله رب العالمين. الشيخ عبد الكريم بيعمل بصحة هذا